All right, so let's talk about LTX-2, the model that a lot of people believe might actually replace WAN 2.2 in the future. Resolution is better, temporal quality is better, and the model is showing potential, even though the current workflows are honestly still a mess. In this video, I'm going to show you what's realistically possible on an 8 GB VRAM GPU, how to make the official FP8 workflow run without out-of-memory errors, and if your specs really can't handle it, I'll show you
Buttons
GGUF
raises. What can
workflows
I
that
get
give
paid at?
similar visual results with much lower requirements. This video is long, detailed, and practical, so if you want to save yourself days of debugging, stick around. Before we get into setup, we need to address the hype. Compared to WAN 2.2, LTX-2 actually does look cleaner and sharper, especially above 720p. Audio comes bundled with the video, the resolution ceiling is higher, and generation speed is faster than WAN 2.2 in a lot of cases. Text-to-video is surprisingly good, and real human and cartoon styles are already showing strong potential. But
Don't
image-to-video is where
underestimate me.
things get
I've
tricky.
got this.
If you're trying anime style, yeah, you're gonna suffer. I spent almost an entire week tweaking prompts just to get a consistent look, and the results were still unpredictable. Workflow maturity is also way behind right now. Some nodes don't show up, some templates refuse to load, and OEM errors keep shutting down the pipeline. I personally can run FP8 without issues, but when I started converting
I never
workflows to
thought I'd see this
GGUF,
place again.
I kept getting artifact
Everything looks
noise
so
in the
different.
output, and I had to reverse engineer the traits to figure out why it sometimes works and sometimes doesn't.
Wait, you didn't
I'll
mean
show
it
you
like
how to
that,
fix
right?
that later in this video so you don't waste the same amount of time that I did. And finally, the model is currently contaminated with Chinese variety
Finally,
show
a
caption
day like
data,
this
so
makes
subtitles
everything
randomly
feel
appear in
right.
some samples. This is normal for now because the dataset isn't fully aligned yet. Now let's talk about the elephant in the room, 8 GB GPUs. I've made a lot of videos about how different models can be forced to run on 8 GB of VRAM and whether it's actually worth doing. So the big question is, can LTX-2 run on 8 GB? The answer is yes, but only if you do it correctly. The main reason is that LTX-2 offloads a large part of its execution into system RAM. The official FP8 checkpoint is around 27 GB in size, which means VRAM isn't the only bottleneck anymore. VRAM holds the active tensors while the model weights are streamed through system memory. Once you push resolution to 720p or 1080p, tensor allocations start to explode. That's where you get out-of-memory errors, not just from VRAM, but from system RAM as well. And when RAM fills up, Windows automatically activates virtual memory and begins paging to your SSD. So for 8 GB GPUs, the real bottleneck is not actually VRAM, it's RAM. Here's the realistic breakdown. To run FP8 LTX image-to-video at 720p or 1080p on an 8 GB GPU, you need at least 64 GB of system RAM. It is technically possible with 32 GB RAM, but only if you enable 2x virtual memory in Windows. I don't recommend this because the paging load will chew through SSD lifespan extremely fast. Most people who tried LTX-2 for the first time couldn't even find the workflow, and the reason is actually very simple. Your Comfy UI front end is outdated. To update it, go to your Comfy UI portable folder, click Update, then click update_comfyui.bat and let it install. Don't close the window, just let it finish. From what I've seen in my comments section, almost every cannot load workflow issue comes from this one problem. Your front end was never updated properly. If updating doesn't help, then you probably need a clean install of Comfy UI Portable. I mentioned this in my previous videos. Sometimes the update patches don't overwrite older UI files, so a clean install is faster than troubleshooting. When you update correctly, you'll see the official templates under Templates, LTX Image to Video. If you don't see this folder, it means you didn't update properly. Simple as that. Now, a few people also reported a Python error. NunType object has no attribute of params. If you get that, your Python is still 3.11. LTX-2 requires at least Python 3.12.10. so make sure your Python version matches. Once all that's done, UI updated, Python updated, then we can start modifying the workflow. Now here's the part that actually makes 8GB usable. We're going to install a custom node called Reserved VRAM. This node dynamically caps how much VRAM the workflow can use. That prevents out-of-memory errors on your GPU and forces the model to offload the rest into system RAM. And please, do not use the old code trick that some YouTubers show, where you manually edit the launch.bat file. That method isn't dynamic and isn't the correct way to handle LTX2. Here's an example of how to set it up. 8GB VRAM, set reserve equals 1GB, model uses 7GB. 32GB VRAM, set reserve equals 24GB, model uses 8GB. Simply connect the reserved VRAM node between the model loader and LoRa loader, and that's it. Once this is done, VRAM will never exceed the reserved limit. The trade-off, of course, is RAM. If your RAM fills up and Windows activates virtual memory, your SSD will take over the load, so keep that in mind. Next, let's configure the checkpoint workflow. For this demo, we're going to use checkpoint FP8, VAE, same base model FP8, text encoder, I use Gemma FP8, LoRa, distilled 384, upscaler, spatial upscaler, FPS, 25, width and height divisible by 32 plus 1 recommended. But don't worry, even if your width and height don't exactly match that rule, the model will automatically adjust the tensor shapes internally so you won't crash just from that. Now, if your hardware just isn't enough for FP8, the best fallback solution is the GGUF model. I've prepared 3 GGUF workflows: text to video, image to video, and first, last frame. I've made several modifications to reduce memory usage and fix the errors people commonly encounter when trying to run GGUF. First, let me be very clear. To make the GGUF workflow functional, you must update Comfy UI to version 9.2. This is the latest version at the time of recording. Without updating, many nodes will simply refuse to load or behave incorrectly. Now let's start with the most basic workflow, text-to-video GGUF. The first thing you need to do is change the Load VAE node to VAE Loader KJ. This is extremely important. The default Load VAE Comfy Core does not properly support the LTX2 VAE. That's why you get artifact noise or pixel garbage in your output. Honestly, I don't know how some people online say they can run it with the default node, because for me, it absolutely does not work. When I switched to VAE Loader KJ, the artifact noise disappeared instantly. But be careful, even in the forums, some users still report artifacts even after switching, so everyone may vary. Next, let's talk about the difference between distill GGUF and dev GGUF, because the file sizes look the same and many people get confused. Even though the files are identical in size, distill GGUF contains a distilled LoRa, but dev GGUF does not contain a distilled LoRa. This is important because if you load dev GGUF, you must manually load an additional distilled LoRa. That means extra memory usage, and if you skip it, you will 100% get artifact noise again. So for most users, I recommend using distilled GGUF. It avoids the extra LoRa step and avoids OOM errors. Next, for the dual clip loader, I use Gemma FP8 as the text encoder, and for embedding connector, I use the distilled safe tensor, since this matches the distilled GGUF setup. For audio VAE, make sure to load the LTXV audio VAE loader. I'll place the folder path in the description or show it on screen so you know exactly where to put your files. You'll also notice that this GGUF workflow is much simpler. That's because I removed the upscaling part, which consumes a huge amount of memory. Don't worry, the output still looks great without upscaling for text to video. Since we don't need an image input here, we use an empty video latent. The 3 input fields must all be integers. The first 2 integers control your width and height, and the last integer controls your video length in frames. Now, based on what I've tested, width and height should ideally follow the divisible by 32 plus 1 rule, and the frame count should be divisible by 8 plus 1. But again, even if you use invalid numbers, LTX2 will silently correct them internally, so you won't crash from that alone. I set the frame rate to 24 FPS, and here are the results I generated using the text-to-video GGUF workflow.
It's raining, it's raining, I love it when it's raining.
My teacher said I'm procrastinating again.
Mom, I watched you reorganize your entire bookshelf by the emotional damage level of each novel for 2 hours, without blinking.
That was...
Next, let's move on to the image-to-video GGUF workflow. Everything is the same as the text-based version. The only difference is now we load an image and pass it into a resize step. Here, I'm using Layer Utility to resize instead of Resize Image, but honestly, you can use whichever one you prefer. These are the image-to-video results.
Wait, what do you mean we have to submit it today?
Sometimes I wonder if I'm doing okay, but I think I'll be fine.
Don't underestimate me. I've got this. Finally, a day like this makes everything feel right.
Finally, let's move to the last workflow. First, last frame, FLF. You will need one additional custom node, LTX First Last Frame Control, TTP. You can install it through Comfy UI Manager, and the name is Comfy UI TTP Toolset. Once that's installed, add another Load Image node and connect it to the Last Frame input. Simple as that. These are the results I generated using the FLF GGUF workflow. While watching the result, I want to make a summary on how to prompt for both workflows. The biggest mistake people make is treating prompts like keywords. LTX2 doesn't want keywords, it wants a shot description.
I'm really happy.
So here's the mindset shift.
Me too.
Think like a cinematographer describing a scene, not an artist listing ideas. The core rule is, when writing prompts, focus on detailed, chronological descriptions of actions and scenes all in one flowing paragraph. You should start directly with the action, describe what happens first and then what follows, and be literal, precise, and visual. Keep it under 200 words. No fluff, no metaphors, only what the camera sees. Here is an example of an LTX2 prompt. If your prompt reads like a shot list turned into a paragraph, you're doing it right. Action first, details second. Camera always matters. Now let's move on to the final workflow, which is custom audio, basically similar to WAN 2.1 Infinite Talk. Here, we're using the Melband Rowformer model, which handles audio separation and enhancement. It can remove or isolate vocals or instruments from a track. I've placed the download link on the side, so you can grab it if you need it. Personally, I like to trim the audio I need inside my video editor first, before bringing it into the workflow. In this example, I'm using a vocal track so the girl can sing and lip sync to it. And honestly, it looks good enough. I'm not too picky here. What does it feel right every time I let you in? And that brings us to the end. In conclusion, is LTX2 better than WAN 2.2? Honestly, that depends on what you're trying to achieve, your hardware, and your workflow. Both models have strengths and weaknesses, and different users will prefer different results. But what do you think? Let me know in the comments. And as always, I'll see you in the next video.